so happy as well to be here. Okay, today I will try to present some experiences that made me feel the need to problematize the concept of choice. And it seems that it's very far away from the topic of this panel, but it's not so much. It seems that choice is a key word to the study of contemporary intimacies in many ways, both as part of people's account of their self-representation, the way they present themselves, or as part of the analysis that sociologists make of contemporary transformation of intimacies, that usually is described as the range of options going wider and wider when it comes to arranging one's intimate life. But as I said, I think we should problematize the concept of choice. And at the end of this talk, I hope to make a more general point about the need to construct different narratives of our life in order to have at least some chance to try to find ways to fight neoliberalism and the heterosexist organization of this society. Wow. This talk is based on field research that has been going on in different ways since 2009, that focuses on relationships of intimacy, care and support that do not reproduce the model of the nuclear family, including that very basic and minimum form of it, that is a naturalized way of living as a couple, the normal, the standard of living as a couple. So the research includes relationships that can be sexual or non-sexual, heterosexual or homosexual, long or short-lasting, implying different degrees of commitment. My research as an anthropologist and as an academic worker is part of a wider project, a collective research undertaken by transfeminist and queer groups, of which I'm part. It started as a self-inquiry in my group Laboratorio Smascheramenti in Bologna in 2009. It went on with or through my master thesis in anthropology, and now it's going on in a wider network of queer and transfeminist groups based in various parts of Italy called Son Movimento Nazionale. I had a slide with
the website.
Doesn't matter. I can give you the links afterward. So I want to state it clearly. My PhD is not a research on the work of Son Movimento Nazionale, but rather part of it. And I don't think, and we don't think, that the kind of knowledge I produce when I wear the clothes of the anthropologist is on a different level of the knowledge we produce as activists. By the way, we have in the audience many people that are from Son Movimento Nazionale, so I'm talking all, I mean, this work is also their work. And I know I should say much more about the queer epistemology and the methodology that is behind all this, and the many contradictions that I and other comrades face when we when working in the academia, but the way we try to manage them, but I don't have time, so I ask you to trust me. And and if you want to know more, there is on our blogs, so there's also something about academia and activism, so maybe we can talk about it later at lunchtime.
This slide maybe was important because I summed up some characteristics of participants that are among 25 and 45 regarding age, and are all Italian legal citizens. Almost all of them are white. They're
queer people, most of them cisgender, but also some transgender people. And okay, it's the second slide. No, the third. Yes, this one. Great. So don't give any statistical meaning to it. It's just a way to, very rough way of locating ourselves and to make you understand from the experiences of whom this reflection comes. So what do we mean when we talk of families of choice? Usually we imply both that we choose a lifestyle that is different from the normative one, the one that is given you, to you by default, and second, that we choose the people we want in our family. And this idea that we choose the people is based on the belief that relatives are given and friends are chosen. This is a big mantra that is shared by common sense and most part of social research on this topic. In this binary between given and chosen, partners seem to be somehow in between, because it's true that you choose your partner, but then, especially if you decide to get married or to do things together that cannot be easily undone, like having children, for example, your partner becomes a given to some extent. But now from our self-inquiry, it emerged that sometimes we develop affective relationships with people we didn't choose, with people, in some cases, with people we would have never selected if we had to choose them. And I will describe just one example of this, that is the one of causal flatmates, the flatmates you don't like. Most of us had been sharing their flat with flatmates, and sometimes they were friends we chose to live with. Sometimes they were strangers at the beginning, but then become friends. And sometimes we didn't like them at all. But still, also with this kind of flatmates, some kind of affection emerges. Either you want it or not, and even if you don't talk about yourself with them, by living together you come to know each other in a very intimate way. You have to accommodate to each other's needs, state of mind, mania and habits and so on. If the person needs something and you can do it easily, you do it. So it's a very light and uncommitted form of care, but by doing it you get somehow attached to these people. And people used to tell me, you know, it's obvious, it's spontaneous when you live together. Later on, some Italian dykes living in France and Germany told me that this is not obvious at all over there. And we discussed about it, and we came to the idea that this thing depends a lot on certain material conditions and cultural conditions as well. Material conditions can be, you know, being precarious workers, or the way flats are physically organized, the common kitchen and so on, also the fact that we were living far away from our families of origin. As for the cultural part, yeah, it's our culture of food, of meals, the fact that it's very impolite in Italy to eat alone and so on. But also in a broader sense, probably we took something from the culture of family of southern Italy, this idea and the practice that you have to be there for your family, you don't choose, or even if you don't like them, and it's often a very extended family. We think that, in a sense, we reworked this in a queer sense. So we made something queer out of this supposedly backward and straight culture. Another example of not so chosen loved ones can be ex-partners or ex-best friends, ex-cohabiting friends, people with whom we even choose to stop a close relationship, but in a sense are still part of our lives and can be called at need, especially when you are in deep shit, you can call them, especially for material help. Now, all these not-so-chosen loved ones provide us with safety and care, made us feel lot and contribute to make to making our affective lives very rich. By saying this, I don't want to fuel this rhetoric of love as a natural, uncontrollable force that escapes rational calculation. And by the way, I'm not talking about falling in love, but I'm talking about getting attached, about affezionarsi in Italian. And I conceive love or affection as something very material that emerges from sharing the space, from the bodies being in the same space, sharing needs, experiences. And of course, it's not my point either to emphasize that choosing your loved ones is a privilege. Of course, it is a privilege reserved to people that have money, that have a big flat, so they can choose to live alone and free time, etc. But this is not my point. My point is that the language of choice can be misleading, and also that the possibility to choose your loved ones is not necessarily desirable. Because sometimes those we didn't choose, or what we didn't properly choose in terms of relationships, contribute all the same to our emotional and material well-being. Now, let's try to focus more on what is, after all, the topic of this panel, polyamory. Not all the people that were involved in this research had the practice of non-monogamy or open non-monogamy, but many of them had. And among those, only a few used the word polyamore to talk about themselves. And those who did so with some critical distance. Why? Well, this has to do with the meaning that polyamore got to have in the Italian context. Okay, I'm not talking in general about polyamory literature or whatever. This is the way it worked in the Italian context, in the perception of these people and in my perception, in my experience. So first of all, many of us started to practice non-monogamy long before the discourse of polyamory arrived in Italy. And I say arrived because most of the discourse is produced by self-identified polyamory communities in Italy are translations of articles coming from the US. So it was really felt as something that arrived at one point, going in the media, mainstream media, and so on. Another aspect is that self-identified polyamorous communities in Italy are very straight, in the sense that they are open to any sexual orientation. Straight people in there are very open-minded, this has to be said, but they start from a straight couple-centered perspective. And this is not a problem in itself, but it becomes a problem when it's not acknowledged. And this is a problem that when you pretend to be neutral, and this is a problem for queer people. Then, for many of us, non-monogamy is part of a wider effort to decenter from couple and its rules, and from romantic love. So on one end, we had problems with the word amore, and on the other hand, we find it this emphasis on negotiation and consent, we find it too couple-centered and couple-reproducing. In our past experience, many of us tried to negotiate rules and consent within the couple, and it didn't help much. Most of the time, it just reinforced the taking for granted right of the partner to put limits on the other's sexuality, or to demand for care and attention without limits, sometimes precisely for arguing about the conditions and the rules. So there are many more acts, but trying to make some more general sense of them, I think it's useful to recall a little bit what Foucault and others say about the neoliberal discourse, neoliberal governance.
So I will make it very simple, even if it's not. We are told that we have a wide range of options in terms of how to lead our lives, that we have to choose those which suit us better in order to be happy and satisfied and fulfilled. We are told that having to choose can be tiring, scaring, but anyway, this is the way it is. And obviously this possibility to choose goes together with risk and with a demand for security. Many critiques has been made to this neoliberal discourse, one of which is that the content of this fulfillment is normative. So for example, it's believed that having a long-term and committed relationship is necessarily part of this fulfillment, and if you get to your 30s and you don't have it, and you even worse, you don't desire it, there's something wrong with you. And of course, this fulfillment implies having a couple, having a monogamous couple. Yes, of course, this cultural discourse we have to fight against it. I think that this critique, in a sense, is still internal to the logic of individual choice. It says that we should be free to choose in this neoliberal sense, but this freedom is not complete, not yet, so we have to fight to include more and more options in the range or more and more people in the process. On Valentine's Day in 2015, il Movimento Nazionale published a statement that makes this point of mononormativity, but goes also further. And it says that this idea of personal fulfillment per se, in itself, independently from its content, is a device of governance. It implies that if you are not happy, not successful, it's your fault. You just have to try a little bit harder. So it's a way of saying that the quest for happiness is an individual affair. It's a way of depoliticizing the quest for happiness. Going back to polyamory, a participant, one of those that did not identify with polyamory, but had a non-monogamous practice, once told me that this emphasis on rules, boundaries, agreement, is a way of trying to get the guarantee in advance that you won't fuck it up with your relationship if you have sex with someone else. But obviously, even if you get it, this guarantee is illusory. You don't know how it would feel until you don't do it, right? As anything else in life. I know that also for some people that identify themselves as polyamorous, this discourse of negotiation agreement is not actually orienting their practices. But so I wonder, what does it mean, this emphasis on negotiation? Isn't it, among many other things, a way of representing ourselves as responsible individuals that, you know, take care of risk management? And obviously, risk management is a very important part of the way we are, our life are disciplined, and I think time is running. So, but you know what I'm talking about. Risk management is a moral duty. It's a way to demonstrate that you are a grown-up, that you're a responsible citizen, and especially if you don't choose the most normal or normative lifestyles, you have to demonstrate that you're doing it responsibly. I think that making space for what's not chosen in the narratives of our lives is a way to construct a deresponsabilized subjectivity. I don't know if deresponsabilized makes sense in English, but in Italian it does. I know, you know, I mean resisting to this pressure
to hold ourselves as individual responsible for the risk we take, responsible for our happiness, responsible for our own self-reproduction, or how will you live next month, make plans for the future, what job will you be able to find, and so on. So I think that making space for not so chosen loved ones, among the rest, could be a way to construct a subjectivity that is less vulnerable to the promises and the threats of neoliberal discourse. So this is what I want to also discuss with you, because it's not something that we discussed very much in some Movimento. It's an idea we came with also with Liana. So yes, that's it.